Welcome to the Archaeology Studio. Today's episode concerns how archaeology relates with other studies of the past. By the end of this episode, you should be able to identify a variety of approaches for learning about the past, discuss how they ask different kinds of questions, and clarify the role of archaeology relative to these other fields. This presentation will refer to geology, history, language studies, and cultural anthropology, first in general terms and then with specific examples of how they overlap with archaeology. Throughout its existence as a discipline, archaeology has been closely allied with geology. Geological principles guide archaeologists in comprehending the original concepts of sites, layers, and individual artifacts. The law of superposition probably has been the most important contribution from geology in archaeological research. In natural geological formations, you can see a profile where the older layers are positioned at the bottom and the younger layers are positioned at the top of a sequence. Each new layer is superimposed over something older. For each identified layer, archaeologists can describe the artifacts and other findings, link those findings with associated environmental parameters, and assign absolute measured dates, such as by radiocarbon. Knowledge from geology is necessary for understanding the physical context of archaeological findings. In any excavation, archaeologists need to make sense of how the layers had formed originally and then transformed through time. One example is shown here at Unaibaput in Saipan, where geological knowledge was instrumental in differentiating the context of 3,500 years of separate site layers, features within those layers, and individual pieces of pottery and other artifacts. For the last few decades, geoarchaeology has been recognized as a way of addressing archaeological questions with the use of geological principles, methods, and techniques. Geoarchaeology could be considered as one essential part of archaeology, as a specialized subdiscipline, or as its own independent field of study. Next, I would like to shift attention to more of the social sciences, beginning with history. Historical studies typically work with written records or other documentary evidence. In some parts of the world, written histories began within just the last few centuries, but in other areas we see much older written records. Perhaps the world's oldest known writing has been dated about 3500 BC in the Sumerian city of Kish in the form of a tablet marked with an early prototype of cuneiform. Written histories always involve a degree of bias about the people, places, and events that were recorded. Historians learn to read between the lines of texts to understand historical contingency and contexts that may not be obvious at face value. Historical site ruins and artifacts provide a fuller picture of the lives of people who may not have been mentioned in the histories written by others. One such example comes from finding a red, glossy pottery across much of Europe attributed to the influence of the Roman Empire about 2,000 years ago. Many of these items were manufactured in Roman Gaul or France and then exported into other territories. They reveal more about the people who made, traded, and used these objects in their everyday lives, even though they were not featured specifically in the Roman historical archives. In many parts of the world, the first known written accounts were recorded by foreign visitors, often accurately, but with some bias. One such example comes from Guam and the Mariana Islands, where the first written encounters referred to sporadic interactions that tended to be misunderstood and sometimes violent. Moreover, these records of the 1500s through 1700s often were sparse or vague, given that navigational charts and related information could be regarded as government secrets among the competing interests of Spanish, Portuguese, Portuguese, Dutch, English, and other foreign powers. History and archaeology often overlap in sites dated to known historical periods or associated with recorded historical events. In these cases, significant knowledge can be gained from historical archives, from personal recollections, or from archaeological material evidence. Major events, such as World War II, greatly shaped world history, and the results are commemorated in many historical sites. One related example was at the Tafuna Air Base in American Samoa. While no actual war battle occurred here, the development of the airbase brought Samoan culture into the international scene of the 1940s. Meanwhile, the airfields, roads, and other constructions became formally fixed elements of the infrastructure and landscape still in use today. Declassified government documents provide extensive information in the forms of engineering maps, administrative records, photographs, and more. The archived engineering map could be aligned perfectly with the modern maps as a way of testing what still remained of the airbase intact today. Some of those intact elements were quite obvious, such as seen here in these sets of defensive gun emplacements. Other elements were entirely absent, or they had become obscured or difficult to see in the field, such as you see here in this digital overlay of a yellow highlighter that shows where an old roadbed once existed. When studying historical sites, we need to consider how we are learning about the site's significance and context. Sometimes archaeology is not involved at all, but other times it can contribute to some degree along with other perspectives. Next, I would like to introduce language as one way of learning about the past. Whether or not we realize it actively, we all speak languages that reveal something about our histories, or about the histories of the languages that we speak. Many different fields of study involve language, but most relevant for archaeology is the field of historical or comparative linguistics. In this approach, linguists look at the diversification of groups or subgroups within a language family, and they examine how they split or diverged or developed in other ways through time. Looking at the geographical distributions of modern-day language families, many areas show the results of English, Spanish, and other European languages that spread through imperial expansions. In other areas, such as in Europe, the language map refers to older expansions of populations. Similar cases can be seen in Africa and Asia. The Austronesian language family has been among the most informative examples in historical linguistic studies. It is spread over a large part of the world, including many groups and subgroups in most of island Southeast Asia, much of the Pacific Islands, and even as far as Madagascar off the east coast of Africa. Historical linguistics studies have outlined how the Austronesian family developed through time, in several steps of splitting or branching of its groups or subgroups. The oldest features of phonology, grammar, and vocabulary were retained in the Formosan languages now spoken in Taiwan. Other branches of Austronesian then split with their own distinctive features, and they continued to develop independently of the language histories in the Formosan and other groups. Austronesian language history is clear about the relative order of how its internal groups and subgroups split or diverge from one another, but linguistic study alone cannot pinpoint the timing of when those splits or branches actually occurred. For this reason, linguists look to archaeology and others to provide datable contexts. The first clue for archaeologists is to acknowledge that one major part of the Austronesian world, in Southeast Asia, had been inhabited for more than 50,000 years, while the remote islands of the Pacific were settled much more recently. The Austronesian languages in the Pacific Islands could not possibly date older than the first archaeological evidence there, beginning about 1500 BC in the Mariana Islands and continuing as recently as AD 1300 in New Zealand. by comparison to what we see in the Pacific, the Austronesian languages could be much older in islands Southeast Asia, but very importantly, Austronesian languages did not penetrate into all of this region that was settled 50,000 years ago. Most likely, people already had been living in this region as far as Australia and New Guinea at some time before the Austronesian languages arrived as an overlay of what already had been there. When mapping the internal splits or branches of Austronesian, a picture emerges of an origin in the Formosan languages of Taiwan, followed by a gradual expansion to the south and east across the Asia-Pacific region. Outside Taiwan, the first Austronesian expansion can be equated with the Malayo-Polynesian grouping found in most of island Southeast Asia. So far, at least three major groupings have been identified, each with a number of internal subgroups. The most recent expansion of the Austronesian family into the remote Pacific has been equated with the Oceanic grouping, and it can be subdivided into several parts. With this map of the major groupings of the Austronesian language family, now we can begin to overlay the distributions of material archaeological signatures. As already noted, the oldest archaeological evidence in the remote Pacific contains distinctive forms and styles of pottery dated about 1500 BC, so we can look for the predecessors of those pottery traditions in older sites of Southeast Asia. The Asia-Pacific pottery trail can be traced back to Taiwan. Even older pottery was in mainland China, but the first occurrence within the known Austronesian world was in Taiwan, where cord-marked pottery has been dated at least as early as 3000 BC, and perhaps some centuries earlier. Within Taiwan, pottery traditions underwent a number of changes, transitioning into a red-slipped earthenware by 2500 BC. This kind of red-slipped pottery then became the first ever pottery made in island Southeast Asia, specifically in the northern Philippines by 2000 BC, and corresponding with the split from the Formosan grouping into the initial branch of Malayo-Polynesian. Within the Philippines after 2000 BC, the red-slipped pottery developed with new characteristics that were not seen in Taiwan at the time. The decorations were made with dentate stamping, circle stamping, fine line incisions, and highlighting with white lime infill in those decorations. This tradition was well established by 1500 BC, and by then it expanded into other parts of the Philippines and Indonesia. Meanwhile, this pottery was part of the repertoire of the first people who lived in the remote Pacific, specifically in the Mariana Islands by 1500 BC. Shortly thereafter, by 1300 BC, a related decorative tradition appeared in the Bismarck Archipelago, east of New Guinea, where now it is known as Lapita pottery. This Lapita pottery later extended over a much larger region, found in many of the islands of Melanesia and into parts of West Polynesia, in a narrow time window of 1000 BC through 800 BC. The next major expansion in the archaeological record has been seen in sites of central through eastern Micronesia, beginning about AD 100 through 200. In those sites, the material signatures included plain, undecorated pottery. The final population expansions were into the eastern provinces of Polynesia, all after AD 1000. By that time, pottery was no longer part of the Polynesian cultural inventory, although it was found elsewhere in the Pacific, and instead the site layers in Polynesia have revealed stone and shell tools as well as discarded food middens. The last known Polynesian expansion was into the New Zealand area around AD 1300. We could explore the Austronesian story in much more detail, but for now I hope that you can appreciate the major findings as demonstrated by a combined effort of historical linguistics and archaeology. Austronesian cultural history could be studied from a number of other perspectives, and now I want to shift our focus to learn about anthropology as one way of learning about the past. Among other places over the years, I was fortunate to work in Uvea of the Loyalty Islands in New Caledonia in 1998 and 1999 with the team now called to the Institute of Archaeology of New Caledonia and the Pacific. While working with the research team, I was hosted by the Matawa family who lived next to our excavation site. While they were curious about me, I learned about their way of life every day. The house floors and walkways were paved with shells and small pieces of coral, much like seen in the archaeological sites dated some centuries older. I measured how much of this paving material could be gathered and carried per hour, and quickly I learned that it was more than just a technical operation. The social event was important for interpersonal relationships, and it was especially attractive for children who easily could handle the labor while playing. I would like to mention another example in Uvea related specifically to the archaeological excavation. Often in these site layers, traces of old cooking features contained lenses of ash with arrangements of small ovals that looked like the parallel lines of wooden stakes. These archaeological features matched with the components of modern-day grills for cooking fish. People use these grills on a daily basis at informal camps along the beach, including at our excavation site. This example of the fish grilling device is just one of many examples of how to correlate a specific material archaeological finding with a larger body of anthropological or ethnographic knowledge. These correlations are the major focus of the field or subfield known as ethnoarchaeology. Additional aspects could be studied through experimental archaeology. Now that you have considered a few different ways of studying the past, I would like to return to our central theme of archaeology. Archaeology offers at least three particular strengths. First, it works with observable physical material evidence. Second, archaeology gains its primary data directly from the past. Third, the material evidence can be presented in chronological order, effectively creating a factual narrative of the past. Every archaeological site or layer provides material evidence of what people in the past did in the context of a directly measurable place and time. By comparing the results from multiple sites, archaeologists can explore the geographic patterns of what they see. One such example was in the Asia-Pacific Pottery Trail, but this approach could be applied at any geographic scale. When considering the results from a series of site layers in their dated order, archaeologists can illustrate chronological trends. Earlier, you saw this series of stratigraphic layers at Unaibaput in Saipan of the Mariana Islands. Here, each layer yielded a different range of pottery traditions, and in total, the layers showed how the pottery changed through time, spanning more than 3,500 years. The same site layers contained abundant shellfish remains, and again, those findings revealed a long-term chronological change. Larger goals in archaeology involve explaining these patterns and trends that we see in the archaeological record. The logical thought process entails at least three steps. First of all, we need to know what happened, where, and when. Second, we can clarify how those material records came to exist in practical terms, such as through the formation of geological layers. Third, we develop ideas of why those material results came to exist. We ask what cultural behaviors or other processes ultimately were responsible. Archaeologists can draw on knowledge from other fields in order to formulate new hypotheses, ideally testable through real archaeological data. As one example of this thought process, I would like to refer to part of the exhibit at the National Museum of Prehistory in Taiwan. Based on archaeological findings in combination with ethnographic knowledge, the museum exhibit includes artistic renderings of what life may have been like in the past. These reconstructions help to build a sense of how the archaeological records came to exist, and then we can develop new testable hypotheses or explanations. As we conclude today's episode, you should be able to discuss how archaeology relates with other studies of the past. You can consider what makes each of those disciplines unique, how they may overlap, and the different kinds of questions that they address. In this way, you should feel comfortable discussing the role of archaeology in learning about the past. I hope that you enjoyed today's episode and that you come back to explore more with the Archaeology Studio.